Hello, it's another It's Changed Leicester Square Theatre podcast. Hooray! It's a good one. It's got Mark Watson on it. But first, this podcast has been sponsored by The Distance. Not the metaphysical idea. It's a band. They're Matt O'Neill and Sophie Jones, a musical duo based in Manchester, travelling all over the country to perform at weddings, birthdays and corporate events. Has it come to this? Our repertoire is huge, ranging from... This is them, so not mine. They say, our repertoire is huge, ranging from acoustic guitar and vocals during your wedding ceremony or drinks reception through to a full-on party set using high-quality backing tracks pumped through a 6,000W rig. I think that's probably watts. Directly into your nan's face. Don't know if... Yeah, that has to be the case. We bring it, especially if your nan is dead. I don't know if they dig her up and bring her into the room. We bring our own lighting, could even DJ too, if you're too stingy to book a separate one. To find out more, get a quote, take a look at the video and audio on our official website, thedistancelive.com, or visit the Facebook page at facebook.com/thedistancelive. And give us a like. It says, P.S. Last weekend we played at the VW Camper Festival in Somerset and got eaten by midges, for which we hold Richard Herring personally responsible. I'm not in charge of all the Somerset midges. Just the ones that I have sex with are my vassals. Anyway, let's enjoy. Thank you to The Distance for sponsoring this podcast. It's all down to them that you can watch this and all the people I mentioned at the end of the show as well. It's Richard Herring's Square Theatre Podcast. Square Theatre, don't be scared. Please welcome Richard Herring. Can't believe I'm back. Welcome one and all to this week's Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast, or as some of the cooler kids have started calling it, Rehearlester-per. Rehearlester-per, that's what it's called now. That's what it's called now. I've got a fantastic show for you this week. And it sounds good job that this week's show and next week's show aren't recorded at the same time, because with me and this week's guest Mark Watson and next week's guest Robin Ince all in the same building, if all three of us were killed in a fire or something, that would cut the productivity of British comedy by about 70%. So it's just the three of us. No one would notice, that's the thing. No one, the general populace wouldn't notice the difference. There would just be a lot less comedy going on if we were all to die, which hopefully we won't. I've had quite a weekend, quite a tiring weekend. I was trying to have a romantic weekend with my wife, mixing it with work, which is always a danger. We went away, we're going to go away to a spa in Tring, which... because I was doing some shows in Tring, and that was part of the deal. They would give us a spa show, but there was a big chain of events. I don't think I've got time to tell you all of what happened during this. I forgot I had a baby for the first time this weekend, and left her in the car for a little while. Just for a little while. It wasn't entirely my fault. We were quite rushed. I'd been in Bristol the night before. I'd come back, got up really early. I was really tired. My wife had a really awful time with the baby, so she was really tired. And we wanted to kind of get away to have this nice romantic weekend as quickly as we could. But then it's difficult when you've got a kid to organise everything. So it was getting later and later into the afternoon. We're getting more and more annoyed. And then we left. And then my wife thought she'd lost her phone. And so then she worried that because she'd been rushing, she'd dropped the phone in the street. So we had to turn. We were in difficult kind of on the West Way out of London, which is very busy at that time. We had to turn around, which took ages, and come back to Shepherd's, which took ages. My street is always full of parked cars on a Saturday because there's the Westfields nearby. And there's beautiful Shepherd's Bush. Do come and live there if you can. It's a wonderful place. Some lovely houses on the market just at the moment in Shepherd's Bush. A man took a shit in my front garden the other day, but it's a lovely place. Don't let that put you off. I deliberately didn't blog about it because I thought someone might read my blog and I'm not going to buy that house. Hopefully I'll have sold the house before this one comes out. But it's karma. I once did that. If you know all my work, I once did that myself. So it is karma that I had to clear up another man's massive shit. That's not even part of the story. So we kind of drove down this road. I dropped my wife off, and then I had to park at the top of the road because I suddenly had a brainstorm. This is how tired we were. It was only when we got home that I thought maybe I should ring the phone.
and see if it's in the car. And I rang it, I couldn't hear anything, but then I thought, I'll get out of the car and I'll hopefully hear it. If it's in the street, I'll be able to hear it ringing. So I ran down the road, then I went in the house and my wife came and said, "Where's Phoebe?" I said, "Oh, yeah, sure, that's her." She's still, it's quite a hot day, I'd left her in the car. My parents did that to me once. I was left in the car for about 20 minutes with the slight window open. I didn't have the window open and nearly died. So that would have been, it's easily done. But it turned out, then I rang the phone again and my wife could hear it, and the phone was in the car. It was tucked into the baby seat. So in a way, neither of us could really get angry with the other one. It was almost, we were all quite fraught, and then actually we'd both done something terribly stupidly wrong. And it was okay. And then I got to the spa hotel. We got there quite late, about 5 o'clock, so we thought we're going to have a drink. And I wanted to go for a wee. And it's quite a posh hotel, had the pretensions of that. Actually, now I've said tring, it's pretty obvious where it is, but fuck it. Which one it is. But the toilet in our room was like full of toilet paper or something, just full to the top of toilet paper. And so I thought, well, I rang down and said the toilet's blocked, which is a bit weird. Hopefully the toilet had been cleaned. You'd think someone might have noticed this huge amount of stuff inside it. So we went down to the bar. This guy came up and we pointed out and said, well, anyway, we're going to go to the bar. We thought, if we come and get us, if you need to move rooms, if this is a problem. And he came down to the bar with a bag with this thing inside it, held up, and said, "Don't flush your nappies down the toilet." I said, "No, we literally just got here. We're not going to flush our nappies down the toilet and then ring you to come and get them." It wasn't us who did that. He said, "I can see you've got a little baby there." So, but no, even if it had been us, you can't, if you run a posh hotel, you can't start accusing your guests. And it wasn't us, so I was quite angry. So it was he was lucky he didn't get punched in the head. So it was quite a time. We had quite a time. Maybe I'll tell you what happened the next day. Everything went fucking wrong the whole weekend. But, you know, it might form part of my next show. So that's a good thing. Oh, look, I've talked enough for long enough. I will bring on our guest. He is obviously, I mean, it's no question what this guy is best known for. He is best known for the show Improvisation, my dear Mark Watson. Nice. Will you please welcome Mark Watson from Improvisation, my dear Mark Watson. Here he comes. There he is. Come in, sit down. Improvisation, my dear Mark Watson.
Yes, that definitely is the peak of my career.
Well, who came up with the title for the show, Improvisation? I've never seen the show, I don't know anything about it. And I don't want to talk about
a difficult period of my career, Richard.
I just want to talk about the title of the show, Improvisation, my dear Mark Watson.
Understandably so.
Who came up with that idea?
And it's easy to point the finger of blame, isn't it? And actually, no, it wasn't me. In fact, I did not sanction the title.
Because, you know, Sherlock Holmes never said elementary, my dear Watson, anyway.
No, he didn't.
And also, he said elementary, my dear Watson, not improvisation.
Yes.
And didn't use the man's first name.
No, he didn't, no. So this catcher was really Watson, you dick. Get off that. Those are your fingerprints. Of course, as people adapt the books, they take on a different form, don't they? It's been a real problem being called Watson, actually. I don't really recommend it. It's a common enough name that people forget you.
Yeah.
But it's also, it reminds people of Sherlock Holmes, and they will do that joke. Yes, unfortunately, this production company had this idea for doing an improv show. They thought I should host it. Yeah. So far, fine. And then the bloke said, "I thought we could call it Improvisation, my dear Watson." But luckily, it didn't look like it would ever be commissioned. So I thought, I just sort of humoured him and went, "Oh, that sounds like a lovely idea." And then unfortunately it was made. Yeah. And suddenly you've got a show called Improvisation, My Dear Watson, and you're called Watson. And you look like a dick, unfortunately.
It's called Improvisation, My Dear Mark Watson.
It wasn't called My Dear Mark Watson, was it?
It was.
I mean, I'll be honest with you, I didn't watch it.
That is what...
I mean,
if it was called Improvisation, My Dear Watson,
I thought it
I
was.
Would have been,
until
I would
now
have been
I
less
thought,
angry about
I thought it.
It
was, yeah. Christ. Next you'll be telling me my 18-hour show is remarketed as 24 or something. Yeah, it was a slow burning, but it lands in the end. It was a problem. It was, you'll know yourself, so many sort of TV shows that are pitched in a kind of pie-in-the-sky way, that if someone says, "Can we do this show with you attached?" you don't really mind because you think, well, that'll never happen. Then suddenly it's too late. Suddenly you're watching a title sequence that says, "Improvisation, my dear Watson," and your face is... We will Google this, and I've
Googled it. Believe me, if it was that, I would have let it go, because that's close enough. Improvisation,
but
My
can't
Dear
have
Watson.
Been My Dear Mark Watson.
That shit!
Is that really what it was?
Yeah.
Oh, God, I'm going to have to write that. I thought I had enough problems in my life.
I've had some of the cast of Improvisation, My Dear Mark Watson, on the show.
The
already.
Cast were good. Josie was in it.
Yeah,
Rufus Ham was in it.
Yeah, I think he
was. It was really...
If anyone from that show is on this show, that is what their introducer's been there most famous.
Yeah. It's one of the biggest shows of the decade, to be fair, yeah.
Good, but you've done some other stuff as well. I was hoping
to
make that
bit... never get onto that.
I was hoping to make that bit last an hour. Just a full hour.
The people that made it were hoping that the show would last an hour, yeah.
Let's move on. Well, I want to ask you about cheese, first of all.
I stand my ground on this.
You don't really like cheese.
No, I don't like it.
That's what I understand it.
Yes, I know. People nearly always make that noise. It's perfectly straightforward. I don't like cheese unless it's a binding agent. In other words, in the lasagna or on a pizza or something where the cheese is not a primary flavour, where I'll have it as a binding agent. I mean, this is completely... I don't even know why we're having this conversation.
It's a
completely rational point of view. I just don't like the taste of cheese.
But then don't eat cheese, even as a binding agent.
Yeah, but then I wouldn't
flowers,
be able to...
Flowers are binding. You could eat a pizza with flour on the top.
Yeah, if I never ate any cheese, I would never have pizza, for example. I'd be robbed of lasagna. So my thing is, I'm benign towards cheese, but I won't have it. If you gave me a piece of cheese, I wouldn't eat it.
Sounds like cheese is a major part of those two things that you like, though. So I'm just wondering if you maybe tried some cheese.
No, I don't like cheese,
Richard.
We've
got backstage, we've got the most eminent fromagieri.
Oh, no,
man.
No. The last thing I want to do is eat cheese.
Okay.
I'll just say again, I hate to keep using the phrase binding agent, but So, for example, in the lasagna, you don't really notice you're eating cheese because you've got your bechamel sauces, which I realise is cheese-based, but it's not... Yeah, like, it's not... That's fine. What I won't do is I won't eat a piece of cheddar, I won't eat a piece of camembert in particular, all those soft cheeses that people... cook in the oven and stuff like that. I mean, I think that's inexcusable, really. I think of myself as a liberal, but when someone sticks a camembert in the oven, I think it's time to have a big discussion, really.
If you're eating a baked camembert, the camembert really is a binding agent in that baked camembert. It's
kind of
holding the...
It's a binding agent, but it's also a primary agent, what we call a primary agent. In fact, it is... I was saying in a baked camembert, camembert is the primary ingredient, so I can't tolerate that. Basically, what I'm saying is I hate cheese, but I accept lasagna is really nice. But even within the realm of pizza, I won't have a Four Seasons pizza or... I won't have a pizza where cheese is overrepresented.
Yeah.
You know, I'll have a Hawaiian pizza because the headlines are ham and pineapple and the cheese is sort of... It's actually perfectly sensible. Like, I think kind of we're making a drama out of this, but it doesn't need to be, right?
All right, we'll move on. You are cripplingly afraid of thunder and lightning, I understand.
Yeah, you've
I have done my research.
Done some research. Yeah,
well, the thing is, we share a tour manager, you and I, so I've managed to get some quite good...
Bloody Giles.
Yes,
it's a problem, it's a phobia.
What's your problem with... Because do you not think it kills more people than heart attacks? Is that your...
I don't think it. There's no doubt that lightning is Britain's biggest killer, yeah. It's a terrible scourge. I'm terrified of it.
Is it the noise or is it the fire coming from the sky?
It's the massive discharge of what's the word?
Electricity, I believe. Yeah.
The word is wine, I think, unfortunately. It's the enormous amount of voltage going through your... It's terrifying.
Have you been hit by lightning?
No, if I did, I wouldn't be here because I know people claim to have survived lightning strikes, but in reality, that never happens, I don't think. Lightning is a terrible... It's a killer. And unlike things like cancer, we can't solve lightning. Like, it will, as long as we have the planet with these climatic conditions... Climatic means to the climax, isn't it? Yeah. It's awful. Lightning's terrifying. I'm amazed that people aren't scared of it. Every time there's a storm, people quite enjoy storms. We go, let's go out and run around and wave the golf club in the air. And I think it's like, lightning's horrible. horrifying. It's yeah. If you get struck by it, you're I mean, you die. I believe
primitive people were very scared of it when they.
I believe your mum was.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, it's a real. It's called astrophobia. It's a proper. I've had treatment for
have
it.
You? So
I had hypno.
Hasn't worked though, hasn't it? You're
no.
So scared.
Well, I had hypnotherapy for it, but the thing is, being hypnotised is quite scary as well. So that didn't really work. So now I'm in therapy for that process. Yeah.
Yeah, because no, I've seen videos on the internet on some of the channels I like where a man hypnotises someone and then starts fiddling around with them. You'd be worried about that. That might have happened to you. You wouldn't know because you were hypnotised.
No, I'm hypnotised. I've been hypnotised just to say, just to shout when I hear the word chicken or something. Yeah.
I haven't seen you on any of those videos that I watch. They're mainly young women on the one of the videos.
As far as I know, I've not been molested while being hypnotised.
I would quite like to see that though. I'd quite like to see. So amongst all the women, I mean, not that I watch a lot of them.
Amongst the dozens of women,
just suddenly a man in his 40s.
35 this year, Richard.
Okay, sorry. I was thinking of myself.
Oh, I see. The terrible thing is, I think I'd quite like to be. I think I wouldn't. I don't think I'd mind that. If someone's going to interfere with me, I think I'd be.
Well,
under
again,
hypnosis, ideally.
I mean,
yeah.
I'm married. I've been married for 3 or 4 years now. 3.5 years.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying to find loopholes in that whole you're not allowed to have sex with other people thing.
Porn is basically nature's biggest loophole.
But if you were hypnotized by someone and they had sex with you, there's not. You could. Your wife would go, what did you just say? Ah, it's hypnotized.
So, yeah.
But you know, if I'm found in bed with Paul McKenna. I'm golden now. It's fine. There's nothing she can do.
There's nothing your wife can do, but you've got other problems.
And this is a new emergency question. Would you consider having sex with a robot, like in the Channel 4 programme Humans?
Humans, yeah.
Would you consider that as cheating? Because I don't know. That's not cheating, is it?
So it's somebody that has the... It has the properties of a human.
Looks like a human, but it's not. It's just like
I know it's a robot.
It's just a big blender, really, and it's a toaster. It's just if you were having sex with a toaster.
So you're asking me to weigh up having sex with a blender. It's the old blender fucking chestnut.
But it's in the shape of a beautiful woman. But your wife couldn't really complain about that. My wife wouldn't let me do it. We had a big discussion about it.
I think
the technology isn't really there yet.
I think I'd be in trouble, yeah. I think I'd be unpopular.
Yeah.
I mean, the marriage vows don't currently incorporate humans. It's true, but I think, because it looks like a person, I think it would still be seen as poor form, I think, yeah. You know, the fact that you would be able to say, yeah, if it was a droid, I don't think it would completely let you off, no. So, no, I think I'd have to say... I mean, it depends, though. In a way, if it was like so obviously robotic that it's clearly not a human.
That's worse.
Is it?
Yeah, it's perverted. You want to have sex with a not...
If we start criticising people for being pervs, though, then it's a whole other conversation. I'm just saying that you're on safer ground if it's clearly not a human. I think the ambiguities begin when it's too much like a human, yeah. Let's hope the situation never emerges.
Have you ever forgotten that you have a child and left it somewhere?
I heard you talking about that. Yeah, quite often.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, like, they're there every day. You can't always be on form, can you? Yeah.
It's quite a worry. The first time it happens, it's quite worrying because it really is like... No, it's that moment where, where's Phoebe? Oh, yeah. Oh dear. That's quite bad.
And then you sort of get used to it.
Yeah.
Well, I've got two now as well, so you can't like... You can't always be worrying about two at the same time. You're fine if you have two. That's what happens as well. The elder one's 5 years old, so I'm used to the idea I've got an elder. So I never forget him. But now and again, you think, oh, I've really taken care of this situation. I've done the cleaning. Here's my five-year-old. Shit, there's another one. And that's happened a couple of times. Yeah. I left her for... I suppose this will go out, actually, and this will be unpopular. But I did... I left her for a few minutes in a... soft play, which is a facility for children, but she wasn't in the bit. She was in the cafe bit, and I am in the like serving behind the. And that was, and genuinely, I just had a moment where I thought, I've got two children. So yeah, I mean, it's you shouldn't judge yourself. Your harshest critics will say you've only got one, so it should be possible to remember that.
Yeah.
But you know, it's a lot of, it's, you know, you get used to having life without children, don't you? And then suddenly you've got to factor in a new variable.
Well, then you're tired and there's lots of stuff going on, and your
tired.
Wife's running around looking for phones and stuff. That you know, that it was an exceptional circumstance.
You deserve all the sympathy you can get.
I do.
Out of it, yeah.
She was safe in the car.
Oh, it's not that you left her in a sort of lion's den or something.
I also, when I park the car, I've got an automatic car, and the handbrake should come on automatically, but sometimes it doesn't.
Oh.
And the car, when I parked it, it rolled back a bit, and then a woman and a small boy were crossing the road behind it, and then she looked at me really angrily.
Yeah.
So that also distracted me from, because I nearly killed a child as well.
Yes. And so, it would have been an awkward day if you killed a child and then neglected your
own
child.
And forgot that my own child was there.
Sort of karmic, I suppose.
And that was in prison.
I'm
going to be in prison and go, oh, yeah, I forgot.
No,
which probably
ideally, you remember how many children you have and you don't kill anyone else's children. And then that counts as a good day, I think.
And don't have sex with any robots.
And you don't have sex with the robots, yeah.
Do you think it's wrong that I've only been married for 3 years and I'm looking for loopholes in how I can have sex with other objects, really?
I don't like to judge whether it's wrong, but it's definitely a conversation worth having with your wife, yeah.
But watching pornography on a computer, that's all right?
I don't think that porn even comes under the category of a loophole, does it? Porn is just, it's like milk or something.
What if the if the computer, as you were having sex with it, had a little nozzle that you put your penis into, and you could just, and then that moved around on its own? Would that count as cheating? Because I don't see where.
I don't think it would count as cheating, but I don't think it would count as a very good evening either.
Hand, you could be doing other, stuff with your hands.
Oh, I agree, it's pragmatic.
You can watch.
Yeah, I just.
Then it's going like a little milking machine.
Yeah, I.
Like that, and then is that cheating? Would that be cheating? Or is
so
it, as long as it's your own hand looking and imagining you having sex, or watching having sex with those people?
I think, and you're older than me, and I don't want to give you kind of what might seem patronising lifestyle advice, but I don't think you should jam your cock into the vent of a computer. No, I think if at all possible, you shouldn't do that.
It would be a special device. My computer is currently in the Apple store because it's got something spilled on it. But that's
going to come back with quite a detailed report, I think, yeah. They might be called Genius, but they weren't seeing anything quite like this before. Yeah, I'm not worried about it from a moral point of view.
No.
I just think you can even I'm with the strictures of marriage, I think you can do better than
I'm trying to work out where the sex with the machine becomes unacceptable. That's all I'm saying. So watching a machine and some would say, but being a voyeur, secretly masturbating over the thing on that machine. I don't know why I'm asking you these questions.
No, but I don't know either, but here we are.
I trust you. I feel like you would know the answer.
Yeah, I know. Well, you're having a lovely time. Yeah. I think basically it's fine to do pretty much anything involving your dick and a computer from a moral point of view. I just think you might come away feeling a little bit disappointed with your life.
Okay.
But clearly you've been to lower ebbs before, so. Fine. I take it all back. Stick it in and see what happens, yeah?
I'll give it a go. I've got one more question from Giles for you. Could you tell me what your Aussie Rules Football Prediction League is called?
So, I mean, this is very niche, to be
Thank
fair.
You, okay.
But as you've said, Giles is my tour manager, also Rich's tour manager. The two of us are basically the two English people interested in Australian rules football, which for me is part of a general suite of sport obsession. So we have a prediction league where we bet... not for money, just for honour, on the results of Australian rules football every week. This is our third season. We've had two seasons. I won both the previous seasons. And so I think, understandably, the competition is called the Watson Cup. And every year Giles says that he'll buy a trophy and give it to me. He's never got round to it.
Yeah.
So all I've had out of it is the honour of having it called that.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, this year I'm 12 points up. Which I don't like to dwell on it, but I'm like, there's a lot wrong with me, but I can definitely tip Australian rules games to quite accurate. Previously, the Watson Cup was the name given to the Connect Four tournament conducted annually between me and my dad, which I've talked about this on stage before, but it ended in 1989 because I lost in the decider and I threatened to commit suicide. left a note on the kitchen table saying, I've killed myself because you're better at Connect 4 than me. And my dad came up the stairs, knocked on the door, and I said, yes, and he said, nah, thought not. And as, the name, the Watson Cup, has lain dormant for more than 20 years. But now it's been, and as I say, it's not an ego thing, it's purely that I was the inaugural winner, so that's why I have it.
Yeah. And if you lose, will you kill yourself?
Yeah, probably. You have to try and win.
I don't really like sport, but you do like sport. The only thing I can know that I remember about Aussie rules football, I don't doubt this guy's still playing because this is about 10 years ago, there was a player who had like a finger that was always bothering him and meant he couldn't play Aussie rules football.
He's retired now.
Yeah, he was getting on his nerves.
You say you don't like sport, but you pay close attention to what Lord Sugar says about sport.
This is a good story. He had a bad finger, so he kept on missing games, so he decided to have his finger amputated so that he'd be able to play, wouldn't have to...
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, that's quite a commitment. I admire that man.
Yeah, I think if you're prepared to have a finger lopped off...
so you can play sport.
...to play a game that involves both your hands, it's almost worth admitting you just shouldn't be in sport. Yeah.
Well, I sort of am interested in sport on a comedic level. I find it kind of funny, but it's one of the things I'm not interested in. But I'm not interested in a lot of things that normal people are interested in. Yeah. Like, I'm not that interested in music, and I find sport kind of a bit ridiculous.
No sport, no music.
Yeah.
What do you get up to? Is it mostly just porn?
Yeah, mainly sex with computers. Yeah, working out. Trying to invent a porn bot computer is my... What I'm trying to do in my
business. I understand that. I've got quite a lot of things that I don't do, which the majority of people are interested in. I don't really watch TV. I hardly ever watch TV, and I'm not on Facebook, so I feel alienated from quite a lot of human society. Yeah.
But sport's quite fun. I mean, what I enjoy about sport, which maybe you would enjoy as well, is that I like the idea of people who aren't very good at sport playing sport and people going to watch that. That would be more interesting to me.
Well, yeah.
Than to people who are really good, just people who aren't that good.
It's a shame we don't have a professional circuit for... Somewhat nearly happened there. I nearly made a joke about the Paralympics, and I went, but now I was like, that's. But. You can see why that would have been a catastrophe for my career. And also, it would have been completely distasteful. And I think the great thing is that I definitely didn't make the joke.
You've certainly rescued it.
Yeah.
In a way that just stopping and not saying anything could never have done.
Oh, yeah, no. It's definitely lucky that I brought it up and then backed out of it, I think. Yeah, that was the safest thing to do. Right, on we go!
When you started doing stand-up comedy, you did it with a Welsh accent.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're not Welsh, though. What's going on?
Well...
George, our sound man, said he compared you to that woman who blacked up. Pretended to be black. Because he's Welsh. And I think he's quite offended that you would pretend to be Welsh.
And I did use the black up as well, to be fair. And I did a thing with my eyes. But, they can't see that on the podcast, luckily.
It's filmed, Mike.
But it was that. It was like doing like Chinese eyes, but in an offensive way. But luckily I was doing it in the context of things that you definitely couldn't do because it would be an offensive shtick to it. So yeah, that's fine.
It's interesting but I say it because similarly when
I think this is going really well, by the way.
When I started doing stand-up, I did a kind of Somerset character. I started out as a character as a sort of shield away from being yourself?
It was, yeah. It was much more nerve-wracking to do it as myself. Yeah. And I've sort of got used to it now, but if you are up there with your own voice and personality, you do sort of think, oh, this is shit. Plus, when you're starting out, and I had done a Welsh accent plenty of times before, because my family, my mum's Welsh, I've heard Welsh accents a lot. I grew up in Bristol. So it's very
easy. Is it your real mum or just the woman you call your mum who you have photos taken with?
Yeah, no, my real mum is a Welsh person that I never speak to. But the person that became mum, Shirley Bass is my actual mum. But my real mum, she's got... So I'm used to Welsh accents. Yeah. And at university, the handful of times that I did comedy, I would do it with a Welsh accent. So when it came to doing stand-up, I thought... But the thing is, and it might have been the same when you started, I didn't really have a plan for it to go well. I just thought, well, this will be fine... I'm only doing 5 minutes. When you start out, you do tiny chunks of comedy, so you don't have a long-term plan. And then gradually it went well, and so people started saying, there's that Welsh guy. So I felt I had no option but to carry it on. And very soon, within 6 months of starting my career, I was locked into a sort of Welsh lie. And
Did you pretend to be Welsh off stage?
Oh,
as well?
We went to a gig once and I was doing the Welsh accent in your car because I felt like if I didn't use the voice off stage, and this is why it started to crack for me, because I felt like I can't really do this for my whole life. I would do the gig and I'd get in the car and we'd all be driving home and I'd go, yeah, no, it went pretty well. I'm relatively happy. And if it's a 4 or 5 hour journey, you would think, well, this is for 20 minutes on stage, this is quite a big ask, really, to pretend to be Welsh. And then I got invited to a dinner for young Welsh achievers. And I mean, obviously I went, because at this point in my career, I was very poor, so if I could get a free dinner. But people there were speaking in Welsh, and that was it. So I had quite a long evening. And after that, I started thinking, this won't really do. Yeah. And plus, there was Rod Gilbert at this point. I mean, Rod and I had been in a lot of... our careers came sort of in parallel. So, and I was aware all this time he was much more genuinely Welsh. So for a variety of reasons, I sort of had to drop it. Yeah.
Did you do a show with Rod in Edinburgh, is that right?
Yes, we did a show of, like, Wales's top two comedians.
Were you
comedians.
Pretending to be Welsh?
It was Wales's top one comedian, yeah. But I was from Bristol, it's only 12 miles, yeah. I'm this close to being Welsh.
If there's ever an Anglo-Welsh war, there's every chance Bristol will become part of Wales if that Wales is successful in that war.
Oh, no, I don't think so. No, I like to think Bristol will stay loyal. Yeah. In the I once dreamt there was an Anglo-Welsh war. It's one of my most frightening dreams ever. About 5 years ago, I dreamt I was in my garden, my old house, and there was an England v Wales war. So we were being bombed by the Welsh.
Yeah.
And I was there doing my stand-up voice going, but I am Welsh. And but the... As you can imagine, the Welsh equivalent of the Luftwaffe knew no mercy. And anyway, I woke up and it was basically fine.
Yeah.
As with so many dreams, you've just got to ride it out. Yeah.
I'd just say to the Welsh, you know, remember what happened last time and we will win. So don't even think about
it. Oh, it's not worth it. No,
don't think about it because we'll win.
It's much better if we stay in harmony with it. And the Scottish, really.
Yeah.
You would back England in a war, yeah. Yeah. There's just more manpower. There's far more.
No, I was against Scotland. I'd be quite scared, but not Wales.
We're much more numerous than the Scottish, but
they
are quite fierce, aren't
and
they?
And they don't really care about, you know, staying alive.
No,
they live in Scotland, so you know. It's...
I mean, it's a lovely, can be a lovely place.
Yeah.
Just thinking about
Limmy is a guest in the future if he doesn't hear this one. So it's just practicing for when he's on. Let's talk about this. We'll get this out of the way. Your Magnus cider advert.
Oh, I'm glad we're getting it out of the way.
Yeah.
I was terrified we wouldn't bring it up. Yes, pear cider.
Yeah, it was pear cider. And quite famously, Stuart Lee did a routine about this.
I was going to say, you're not even the first person out of Herring and Lee to bring this up. Yeah. And I'm also the first person to call it Herring and Lee. I don't know why that happened.
That is the correct name. We actually, we had quite a big discussion about which way round it should be.
Yeah.
I didn't really care. Our producer at the time said she thought it should be Herring and Lee, and Stu felt very strongly it should be Lee and Herring.
I find that unlikely.
And
somebody that would let his ego get in the way of consideration.
And I think if I put, we didn't realise for about 2 or 3 years, but I think if I'd said that sounds a bit like Lee and Perrin sauce, and it will look like we've named ourselves after Lee.
That would be awful because that is a commercial product.
It is, exactly.
Yeah. You can't start endorsing things that people pay money for. I might as well say. No, I don't know. Yeah. So here's the state of play between me and Stuart Lee, your erstwhile collaborator, is that I did. You know, there's other podcasts.
Yes.
So
they're not as good, but they're not worth watching.
I feel terrible. So I did Stuart Goldsmith podcast. I referred in a very respectful way to Stuart. Just he said, have you ever thought about having a drink with Stuart Lee and talking through this cider business?
Yeah.
And I said very flippantly, Stuart is too successful now. He's become a sort of idol to the comedy world. I would need a special pass to talk to him. And it really was a flippant remark. But I received an angry email from Stuart saying, I understand from your podcast you need a, in inverted commas, special pass to talk to me. What does this refer to? Why are you... So I was frightened because that's Stuart Lee. I like him. I respect him, and also he can have you deported. He's like the eighth most powerful person in the country. So I wrote him back in quite a detailed email saying it was not meant as any sort of slight on you. I was just referring flippantly to the fact that you now have you have been beatified by the comedy world. People like me feel as if we can't offend you now with that, blah, blah. And it was really respectful. And I replied, and that reply came from me within half an hour of the... Yeah. But nothing, I've not heard back from him.
I don't think he reads his... From my dealings with him by email, I don't think he reads his emails. Well, so he would just say that you've carried on saying that. That's what.
But what it means is that I'm basically communicating with Stuart Lee through podcasts
okay.
now. So, so I'm just, if he's listening to this, please, Stuart, we can work this out, Stuart. I'm sorry about my occasional commercial sellouts.
It seems odd to me when a lot of, I can understand it, because I don't, apart from the stupid adverts I've started putting onto this podcast, I find it sort of compromising to be in an advert in some ways.
Oh, but God,
But I also think it's up to an individual to choose. It seems weird to... People are kind of getting picked on as individuals, and there's so many people who do adverts. That's your own personal view. My own personal view is I don't really want to do them. But I think I could have my arm twisted by £250,000.
That's all you'd want? yes, I have my arm twisted for an awful lot less than that, it's fair to say.
But it's just the point where your arm could be twisted, isn't it?
There was a point where my arm could be twisted, and I think... And I say this, and I've already said this in relation to the advert, and it kind of sounds disingenuous, but I genuinely thought that no one would care at all. Because I'd never done a TV advert before, but I had done, promotional stuff and things for bits. And I just sort of thought, because, I don't know, I think partly I don't watch very much TV, and I don't interact with adverts at all. I never remember any adverts. So I just sort of thought, this is pretty innocuous. I'd certainly never see a comedian on an advert. And I suppose, and again, this sounds naive now, but my radar was Stephen Fry. Fry, at the time, was on an advert for tea bags or something. Yeah. In the 12 months before I did my advert, Fry had done two or three adverts. And I thought, nobody has more respect... more of the love of the general public than Fry. So if Fry can advertise basically anything and get away with it, that must mean that there's a convention where people accept that... But I think what I misunderstood was that I'm not as popular as Fry. So Fry has accumulated a lot of credit already, which means that if he's flogging tea to you, you think, ah, fuck off, but you're still Fry. Whereas when people saw me... But the other thing was, I don't know, I think... Comedy is a very, very left-wing sphere, and I suppose I feel like... I'm a voted Labour. I'm not exactly a... I wouldn't describe myself as capitalist by any means, but I do sort of feel like... Basically, I think my point is adverts are meaningless. I don't think they matter. I think if someone is stupid enough to give you money to advertise something, you might as well do it, unless it's something that's really morally reprehensible. I wouldn't have taken it on if it was something that I thought... If it was a product that I thought people would... But I couldn't imagine people would be offended by Magnus Pear, because it's not even the most successful pear cider, as we all know. In fact, it's third now. There's Copperberg now. And even at the time, it was Bulmers was clearly the market leader. And they were hoping with my campaign that Magnus would overtake Bulmers. But I looked recently, and Bulmers has got a bigger lead than ever. And it was not a very good advert. But I'm still kind of... I do completely understand. I think if I had a sort of Bill Hicksian track record of damning adverts or damning the corporate world in general, then I would be open to charge of hypocrisy. But as it is, I was just hired to do a thing, and I don't really see the harm in that.
And as an actor, really. I mean, it wasn't like, hi, I'm Mark Watson from Improvisation, dear Mark Watson.
No, of course.
You didn't sully the name of Improvisation,
the worry
my
is
dear
that
Mark.
People thought I was surfing the massive success of Improvisation. Yeah. And I understand that that show had its hardcore fans that were upset.
I think there's a level of sort of being patronising about it. And, you know, I think about this a lot because, and I don't, you know, I've turned down the things I've been offered. I don't get offered very much. So it's easy for me to say I'm not that bothered. But I also think there's a sort of patronising element to it. It's like, I understand that adverts are evil, but the people that who are watching this out into the world, they might not understand that and they might be taken in by the lies. Well, so, you know, it seems a patronising attitude in that way.
I do think that a bit. I'm prepared to sort of be wrong on this issue, but, you know, somebody, a well-known comedian, gave me a lot more abuse than Stuart for it. And his thing was like, well, how can you advertise booze? This is a nation of alcoholics. Teenagers that like your comedy are going to see that. And firstly, if the upshot of the advert is that they buy pear cider, we're all safe. Because the amount of that you'd have to drink before you manifested any sort of drunkenness is physically impossible. I drank pints and pints of that during the advert, and there's barely any booze content in it at all. But also, and again, I'm aware that I'm probably swimming against some sort of moral tide here, but I do feel that you should be allowed to advertise products even if you morally disapprove of them, because, you know, adults are going to drink or gamble, or they're going to do it anyway. I understand there's a convention of having these warnings saying drink responsibly. Even that is a bit of a cop-out. It's weird to have 2 minutes of saying drinking's amazing and then at the end go, but do be careful, don't drink. Like, but if you're going to allow the adverts, you have to accept that people sort of make decisions, you know. Yeah. I sort of think, I mean, I drink, much too much. Like, I'm a massive fan of drinking, and it'll certainly kill me in the next 20 years. But I don't blame advertising for that. Advertising merely reiterates what I already know, which is that booze is on sale. I sort of feel like, do you know what I mean? Like, you know, it's not as if someone sees an ad for Ladbrokes and thinks, betting. Well, I've never heard of that. But so to me, it's peculiar to me to talk as if adverts facilitate a form of consumption which otherwise wouldn't be possible. Yeah. Everyone here knows you can buy stuff. If someone advertises it, you're not more likely to buy it. You still make your own decisions.
Yeah.
Against this, it has to be said, I bought a flat from the advert. So I'm completely aware that I'm in a morally dubious position. And to be fair, I've not done an advert since, but not because of that, just because the success of the Magnus advert didn't allow anyone else to hire me. But yeah, I do feel that. I also said this at the time, and I would say it again now. At the time the Magnus advert was offered to me, I'd just written a novel which took 9 months and which ultimately was published, but at the time it didn't look as if it was, but I'd been dumped by my publisher, and I have a lot of kind of projects like that which are quite, you know, labour-intensive and artistically high-minded, and which you get hardly any money for. So if I'm offered something like an advert which is potentially lucrative, although this sounds like something you would say in your justification, I genuinely see it as an opportunity to fund things like, I've written 5 or 6 novels without ever making any money out of them, because that's what I love doing. And I've done quite a lot of other projects which don't ever pay. So that would be my answer to people like Stuart, who see it as a kind of compromise. I think that throughout history, people that want to write things like poems or books or plays have had to rely on the patronage of rich people. And if that takes the form of Magnus Pear. So in that case, as a result of the Magnus advert, I was able to spend 6 more months reworking the novel, and I did get it published. So that's the, in all seriousness, that's the way I justify it.
Well, life sometimes is full of those kind of compromises, and it is a question of whether then something, whether a thing you want to do exists or doesn't exist. Then you know, sometimes you can't stay true to what the 16-year-old you would have said. Maybe
no,
would,
but I think,
but even if the 16-year-old you didn't say, you know, I think sometimes people, especially Stuart, can think, I think this, and therefore it is universally true.
I think
it often is, but
often is, and I do respect him, and I genuinely respect people that are principled enough never to take an advert. I would say, if the 16-year-old me had dreamed of nothing but being a novelist, if that person had been approached and said, so you can, you'll be a novelist, but you'll be chucked by your publisher, and to revive your novel writing career you have to advertise cider, I think I would have definitely said, yeah, fine, do you mean Strongbow or something like that? And then this mysterious person would have said, no, when you're in your 30s there'll be a new type of cider which is made with sort of pears and other soft fruits, and it will never really catch on. I would have said, A, yes, I'll probably do it for my writing ambitions, and B, how do you know this about the future of cider? So, yeah, I don't regret it, I don't think, because I was able to do a year of writing as a result of it.
But was it weird being... I mean, I think it's sort of interesting that then it became a thing that obviously comedy fans... follow Stu a lot, and so did that become a? Did it become more difficult after the routine?
Or well, I didn't like that much because nobody wants to be the butt of the routines of somebody as famous and as oft quoted as Stuart Lee, and but I didn't blame him. At no point did I think it was unfair. I did accept that if you take the money to do an advert, you'll be criticised. Maybe comedically, maybe, but the sad thing really is that I really respect Stuart, and it's hurtful to be criticised by people of whom you have a high opinion. But I don't know. It's true that it's very weird to be in a routine that people come up to you and sort of quote, and I'd rather not that. I'd rather. I suppose I'd rather. The three things that comedy fans most commonly say to me are, third is something about a joke of mine, second is Stuart Lee's thing, and the first thing is, I love your bit about your suitcase, which is actually Rod Gilbert. But of course, I always say thank you very much. Yeah, it's a shame. I mean, it's especially a shame because I'm not particularly... confrontational personality, so I'd never have imagined that I'd be in a situation where I'd made enemies of Frankie Boyle and Stuart Lee, two of the opinion formers of contemporary comedy. And I hate it. I hate being that guy because also because, and again, I hate to kind of, I'm only banging on about this because, well, you've touched a nerve.
Yeah.
But
I did it on purpose.
There are a lot of comedians out there whom you could criticise of riding some sort of gravy train towards commercial success. I would say that, although I did do the advert, I've written all these books and all these marathon shows, and the majority of my career has been spent doing relatively kind of unusual projects that don't make any money and that don't really garner much attention from the general public. So I think what hurts for me is that I like to see myself as the sort of person that is in that camp of alternative, of genuinely innovative comedians. But because of the advert, I don't really have a leg to stand on. But there are times when I think, you write five fucking novels. but I've yet to say that because we only communicate through podcasts. And a sixth one on the way. Plus a graphic novel coming out, and graphic novels aren't lucrative.
It seems unfair out of all the people you could, you know, if you wanted to pick on somebody. I mean, Stephen Fry would be an interesting one to pick on. Johnny Vegas, who was on last week, had done lots of
those are great people to pick on.
People, you know, so it's weird. Some people you go, oh, that's all right. Old Johnny Vegas, we all love him, that's fine. So it's
Because also I didn't get that much money for it. I've definitely got less money than Stuart Lee. Like, it's not as if I'm Frankie for that matter.
No.
Which is the other thing. It's odd to be labelled as a commercial sellout by people that you know are more commercially successful than you.
Yeah.
Like, it's not... Well, I don't know, I haven't asked Stuart how much money he's got. again, because it's really only these podcasts where we chat. But but it's not as if I've, made an obscene amount of money. And there are plenty of people you could point the finger at within comedy that are doing that. Having said that, Stuart has also targeted quite a lot of those people as well. It's not as if I'm the only victim.
It's true. It's all right to make money, I think, it's all right to make money. I think capitalism isn't perfect, but it's sort of fair that if you do some work, you get paid for it, I think. It makes it easier in the long run, I think.
It does. Let's
share. I worked it out the other day because I was trying to think of something with the show, and I think if you shared out everything in the world equally between every single person, you'd have something like £250 each and £1,000 worth of property. But then, do you have to then, when you even it out, is it like the prodigal son, that if that person goes out and spends their money, then the next weekend it gets evened out again? Are we just going to reset and then...
It's a lot of maths for someone, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it's difficult.
But you're right, I mean, that is a point. If you're talking about what is fair, then really, all of us should give loads of our money to people in Ghana. Yeah, because all and pretty much everyone in this room is a lot richer than is in the top 0.1% of, and everyone knows that.
Yeah.
So if you're going to be criticised for making money, then I think it's legitimate to say, well, you also have quite a lot of money. Why don't you, what are you doing with it?
It's like those people who say, check your privilege on, you know, Twitter or Facebook.
Yeah.
Are you using a computer, which is already
it
worth
means
more.
That they're more privileged than,
Even if they've just got access to it, they're more privileged than most people in the world. Anyway, look, before I forget, I should have said this at the beginning of the show. Daniel Kleinberg paid me some money to say this. Who's the sellout now?
And I don't know. Is it means, about cider?
It isn't. I don't know if it's me or him that he's saying it about, because it's true of both of us. I am an Adams Family billionaire, which makes me a fucking idiot. I should have said that at the beginning of the show. I am a bit, and so is he. He's a guy on Twitter who keeps on posting his high score on the Adams Family pinball.
Right, yeah.
I've got 1.6 billion now, so I think I might be beating him. So, but maybe not.
That's a lot.
And it's, yeah, it's not bad. It's not bad. And are you aware of Britcom, Dirty Britcom Confessions, the website?
Just from yes.
Yeah. There are a few of yours. They're quite a lot actually. They're quite nice on the this sort of this one happened to me in the dressing room as well. This is Mark Watson bent over. I saw crack. I enjoyed it.
I mean, to be fair, I'm so thin in my trousers are so regularly low that's. That's barely a confession. Also, if you didn't enjoy it, there'd be something wrong with you.
But it was
not being funny, but who doesn't want to see a bit of this crack? Most people in the end.
Yeah. We'll as he turns around, have a look. We'll get the cameras in tight.
I'm going to back off now.
Here's another. I want to fuck Mark Watson and cuddle him at the same time. I mean, what kind of person doesn't want to do that? I mean, this person's going, yeah, I'm not just want to fuck him, I want to cuddle him as well. Look at me, aren't I a nice
I'm
guy?
I'm quite enjoying the way the confessions have gone. I think
I call it a fuckle. He's highly fucklable.
Is this a real one?
That's a real one.
Well, I suppose that's reasonably good news. It's nice to think I'm going to get sex and also solace.
Yeah. It's sad to think someone might just want to fuck you and not. I mean, just literally be in you and just.
I was going to
keeping every other part of their body away from you.
You sort of feel like cuddling is part and parcel of it, really, don't you? Yeah.
At least to begin with, just and at the end.
It shouldn't be an enormous confession to go, I want to fuck him, but also touch him. But even so, that. It's very rare someone expresses that level of enthusiasm for me.
These come from this website. They've stopped taking. It's a shame they've stopped taking confessions.
I'm not surprised after this crop.
I would love to screw Mark Watson on my couch and on my bathroom floor. Even in bed would suit me. So it's nice they're flexible. They're flexible.
That's someone that's ready to really go to the worst possible extremes and have sex in their bed.
They're all real.
A lot of propositions like this.
I want to watch Mark Watson masturbate.
Ah. Well, the tone has changed.
We can make that dream come true right now if you want.
It's not a service that I currently offer.
We've got 15 minutes.
If it was for the sake of selling cider, of course I'd do it. But. I don't normally masturbate without some sort of brand attached to it. This is incredible. I wish I was on this site more often.
Yeah, you should go now. It's a very, it's kind of an ego boost and a terrifying.
Peculiar. Why would you want to watch somebody? Even if you liked somebody, why would you want to watch them masturbate? Wouldn't you want to? I've got more sympathy with the person that wanted to just have sex with me while cuddling.
Well, also, are they watching you masturbate? Is it like sitting here and watching you masturbate, or is it watching you like through a window or from a cupboard? We need more.
I think if we're going to do it, I'd rather do it at close quarters in a way. Through a window is peculiar, I think. Yeah.
So it's happening. Yeah.
I would make them a cup of tea afterwards and stuff like that. Yeah.
Wouldn't it make you uncomfortable if there's just? Oh, yes, very interesting.
You're doing it is making me uncomfortable. Yeah, but.
Yes, I might go, go on, masturbate that penis a bit more. Would that be make uncomfortable?
I think I'm still happy with the way this is going, Any more?
I'll ask you, I've got cash for questions. I'll get paid to ask you this question. The guy who's asked this, Andrew McGovern, has so little confidence in himself, he's asked a second question.
in case I don't like the first one, but I'm going to go with this first one. You've been on stage for 27 hours in a row, not just tonight, in another time. What are the first social and psychological niceties to break down under this kind of duress, in case it's of interest to Human Rights Watch?
In case, and many of you won't know, I've done these marathon shows, and the last one was 27 hours long. I think the first nicety that breaks down is just people's names. You forget people's names, right. Even if it's someone really famous. Like, in about the 20th hour, if you had Obama on stage, you would be like, that guy. and also just, you lose your tolerance, generally, I think. Like, people come on and do funny stuff, and you will still chat to them, but you're no longer interested in catering to what they might be feeling, because your thing is always, yes, but I've been awake for 20 hours. So essentially, I suppose the answer is you lose respect for the rest of humanity. because rightly or wrongly, you decide that your situation is worse. Even though it's self-inflicted.
I get that from doing any gig in front with an audience. I lose respect for humanity.
You don't have to be on stage for 27 hours to start to hate the human race. It's true, you can do it within an hour.
Are you on the whole time?
Pretty much. Sometimes there's a guest. I'll have a wee sometimes. Sometimes I'll go and masturbate for money. what would be funny is if you took that previous bit out but kept that in, and then... I think my status with Comic Relief would go down if you edit this wrongly. Sometimes there's, like, you sent a message in last time. Sometimes we show messages on the screen. But, yeah, you are on stage for most of that time. So you basically... you forget how to deal politely with people. Yeah. I think politeness is something which is imposed by sort of everyday routine. As soon as you've been on, you know, even if you've not been on stage for that long, if you're tired in everyday life, you do start to not treat people with as much respect. So it's probably that. Yeah.
What is it about you that makes you push yourself this much? Because obviously, like, doing these are quite extreme things in Edinburgh. You do quite full on. Weird shows, and you're writing novels, which is very difficult, and you're in all these different areas of comedy, and so you're pushing yourself, and I can understand this, and I think maybe my next guest Robin Ince can also understand it.
Ince is worse than me.
Worse than me, so that's
Ince is I mean, he's probably back there listening. Ince is a fucking idiot.
He is. So, yeah. I tell you, I wouldn't want to watch Matt in masturbate, though. That is one that I would not want to see that.
No, I don't think I would, but I don't think I'd want to watch me masturbate, but someone out there does. I shouldn't say it, but I'm really pleased with that. it's not something I thought was on anyone's mind. Don't clap it! That shouldn't be the highlight of the show.
I didn't think that would be a thing. What do you think it is, though, and what is it about the three of us, I think, would be fair to say, that we kind of seem to be obsessed about producing a huge amount of content?
It's a good question. I think it's probably just that... Well, for me, I think it's partly just... I'm always conscious that life is pretty short, and your career in a field like this might be shorter still. Like, no one knows how long you're gonna. To be fair, you've done it. You've hung in there for bloody ages.
I have, yeah.
Yeah.
But you never know when it's.
You never do
but
know.
But it's mainly by me just doing my own things.
Well, that's the thing.
Forcing other people to come on them.
In a way, you sort of have to. You have to accept that if this is your life, then there's a finite period in which you'll be commercially, and not even about commerce. Actually, you're right. It's just purely. I'm 35, so I've got maybe 20 more years of doing this sort of thing before I become... there are comedians older than me, but it becomes... you couldn't do that thing about masturbating if I was 58, for example. So once you're aware that you have a finite period of productivity, I'm just keen to sort of cram it with as much as... But also, I've just got loads of ambitions. Like, there's so many novels that I want to write, and there's just a lot of stuff I want to do, I suppose. That's the simplest answer. Yeah. I'm determined to... And some people... mellow out because they get a family but we've both got Robin's got a family, we've all got kids and stuff. For me, I have not found that any other aspect of life diminishes my appetite for work, basically. I think I just love doing it. That's the simplest answer. I love doing it. And also thank you and also everything I do, like a book or a long show, anything, I can always imagine a better way that I might have done it. So I've always got as soon as a project ends, I think, if I could have another crack at that, it would be that bit better. So in that sense, it's a bit like your obsession with Adam's Family, I think. Work for me is like an app that you know there is a higher score you could get. And it's not purely about, in fact, these days for me, it's not at all about money or even prestige. I don't really mind about my status anymore. There's just this pride that comes from thinking everything I'm doing, I could just do it a bit better.
Yeah,
and that's what motivates me, I think.
Do you think, and this is something I just think about myself, and I don't think it about you, but I wonder whether, like, by doing less, that it might, that might actually lead to becoming more successful. I've done a new show every year for 12 years, and now going back and doing them all again and starting to do little best-of shows, you kind of go, what if I just worked at that hour for 4 years and then done a show rather than done four different shows in 4 years?
I do sometimes think that, and I've had various managers, friends, various people who've said, why do you do so many things at once if you dedicate yourself to one? And a lot of the people that we're up against, dare I say it, a lot of successful stand-ups are pretty much purely doing stand-up, and they devote themselves to that. And I do sometimes think, am I tying my own hands by operating on two or three different... But it's just what I want to do, I think. I don't think I could give up writing... Well, I certainly couldn't give up writing novels in order to just do stand-up. But I don't think I'd want to not do stand-up. So basically, I'm just sort of doing what I feel like I should be doing, I think. There are times when I think, could I have become a sort of McIntyre level, or at least a Russell Howard-sized comic if I had done nothing but... But I think the answer is probably no, because you have a kind of level that you're going to reach as a comedian. I've reached mine, I think. It probably couldn't have been any higher than... In football terms, championship. I'm the 42nd comedian. That's probably where I was meant to go,
maybe,
I think.
Maybe, but I also think you took it, Stuart, something can suddenly happen.
Yeah.
You know, suddenly at a point in your career and suddenly something changes and it becomes something else.
Yeah, and to be fair, that could still happen, I suppose. Yeah. But I suppose I don't regret any of the things like novels or any of the projects that I've taken on which have eaten a lot of time away from my stand-up. And I also don't regret having the stand-up. No, I think I'm just a person that's happiest doing lots of projects, and I'll continue to pursue that even if it's to the detriment of all those projects. Yeah, which is probably a shame. For anyone like Stuart or anyone that might accuse me of being kind of commercially minded, I would say the final disproof of that is that I've willingly pursued 5 or 6 career strands in a row, knowing that all of them are screwing each other.
Yeah.
So I've basically committed career suicide because I really like books. So, yeah. But I think I'm happy with that. And I think you probably are too. I can't imagine you just doing one thing and pursuing
that. And I like, and I like that, and I like... Stu was critical of me for wasting lots of money on doing my last play, and he said I should have thought about my family. But I'm glad that I wasted that money on that life. I'd rather spend the money that I've made from doing other things, which I'm lucky enough to do, on creating more work that hopefully will, you know... But also,
You can't start thinking about your family.
But no. But also, everyone you're taking a punt on, you know, you're taking a punt. If that thing becomes successful, then it will become... The money you've spent or the time you spent on creating it will become commercially viable anyway. But, you know, all you can do with this business, I think, is to just... do what you think's good and hope someone will agree at
some
point.
That's basically exactly the same thing that I do. And stand-up is a very flimsy sort of thing.
Yeah.
Writing is a very... All of the things individually are quite a frail thing to hang your career on. So I think it's worth having those different things.
Yeah.
But also, I would just be unhappy. If I wasn't doing stand-up, if I was just writing books, I'd be looking at stand-ups thinking, I'm roughly as good as Russell Cain. I've got a very different approach to hair, but And if I had purely concentrated on stand-up and not published any books, I'd be reading books thinking, So in a way, if there's something that you desperately want to do, I think you've just got to do it, whether it makes immediate commercial sense or not. Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, Robin is a better example of that even, because he does about 28 different projects, none of which make sense as far as I can see. But again, I don't think he could live any other way. Although he's giving up stand-up, actually. So,
I suspect I'll talk to him about that.
I suspect you will,
And encourage him. I'm going to You're not here till next week. Go away.
I know it's a week away, yeah.
He's hanging around.
But it's almost as if he's watching us.
But I thought, well, this weekend when I went to Tring, they were putting on one of my old plays, Punk's Not Dead, which I did in 1996. And it's weird having gone back with both Vista Fun, which we've obviously re-released ourselves and gone back and had to watch and do commentaries of. And in my mind, I was thinking, that was a great show. It's a shame it never got the recognition it deserved. Yeah. But going back to watch it, certainly the second series, I could understand why it hadn't been recommissioned, even though I thought there's lots of good things in it. I could understand why it hadn't been recommissioned, because it was a bit of a mess, because of the changes they made us make, really. The first series was pretty good, but also you go, okay, it isn't like the lost classic sketch show. It was all right, but it wasn't.
It was good.
But it wasn't.
I was at school.
It was all right, but
you come in on Monday and say the moon and the stick, and everyone liked you.
I think I felt like we'd been overlooked unfairly. Yeah. And but also my solo stand-up shows, going back and looking and listening to them all again in trying to remember them all again, I thought, oh, those shows were kind of, a lot of those shows were great, and some of them I'm very pleased with and they're good, but there's still lots of bits in you go, oh, God, that's not as good as I remember, or I can see why that, yeah. Or at least I can see why that wasn't successful. But interestingly, Punk's Not Dead, which is the oldest of all, well, it's 1996, having seen that again, you kind of go, God, that was like a real, I did really well, that's a really well-written play,
so you
but nothing happened with it, you know.
You should have retired.
I should have retired, yeah. But also it's very easy to do something that's good and nobody really notices.
Yeah, exactly, that is another argument for producing a lot of work, yeah. Definitely. Some of the work that, no matter how good, for whatever reason, will go unnoticed, yeah. Yeah.
Which again, I might talk to Robin Mack if he ever turns up. But you know, The Office was an example of something that which Robin was completely involved with. Something that I think none of the people in there they all were happy with it, but they wouldn't have thought this would go on to be the most successful sitcom ever.
No, you
could
can't.
Easily have been not, you know, just passed, very nearly was passed
you
over.
You can't possibly predict what of the things that you produce people will like.
Yeah,
no.
Or you know, things that are very good can be overlooked. But you know, one thing out of everything I've done. Doesn't really count for much, does it? But so.
Still nice, though.
It's nice to have it. It's nice to see.
Very successful podcast as well.
Oh, I've got that as well, yeah.
Yeah, it's going, yeah. Yeah,
very much dependent on the guest.
Yeah, no. This will do all right.
It's very good. I'm joking. You said you would blog every day for 10 years. How's that going?
Nah, I am. I did do 2 years, and then I had to give up because of. You know, when you have kids,
yeah.
your life isn't, it doesn't really work anymore. So it was that, yeah. Yeah. I would have kept it going, but I had suddenly I was doing. It was a shame, really, because yeah. I used to enjoy.
I've
that.
Done 12 and a half.
I know, I know. Fuck off.
It is a lot harder with the baby. But
yeah.
Then, but then there are. It does give you some things to write about, which some people then get annoyed about. But that's all that has happened to me. This I'm a little bit behind even at the moment. I'm a couple. Of
I was forced to give it up because I was. It was interfering with. It was politically. Yeah. So I couldn't really do it anymore. But on the plus side, I've relaunched Fist of Fun with myself in it. So we've basically got the same career, but we're just doing it in a different order.
I'll ask you some emergency questions. I think you're a very good guest, Mark. I was only joking then.
I think it will do, on the spectrum of your downloads, it will be right in the middle, average. But there'll be someone that listens to it and thinks, imagine him wanking. Yeah. Someone, whoever it is.
Not they want to imagine it, they want to see it.
It's not impossible.
If you could take, I've got a...
Everyone's got their prize.
I've got a section. We should finish quite soon. You've got to do another gig.
Yes, we should finish quite soon.
I'll ask an easy one. I'll ask one easy one. Have you ever tried to suck your own cock? That's an easy one. It's easy.
No,
this is the big end of the show.
Is this literally the last question?
It probably will be, because you've got to go and do another gig. And I forgot.
No, I haven't. I always sort of feel like if you can't get anyone to do it, then you probably have to hold your hands up and say it's not happening. I don't think it's the sort of thing where you can create your own solution, really. Yeah. And by hold your hands up, I mean quite literally, because that does take you out of it, I think. Yeah.
What if someone wanted to watch you?
That would be different, of course, yeah. And as we know, somebody does.
Yeah, probably. Well, that's not up there yet, but if they open submissions again,
but they'll be thinking about it, I'm sure. Yeah. Is that how we're going to end it? We can't, can we?
Yeah, we can. Well, all right, hold on. You were the voice of a rabbit in the Innocence Movies advert.
I just think. Okay, back to the cock.
What was Mark Watson's Drystone Wall show all about?
I didn't see that one.
No, nobody did. Because it didn't happen. On Wikipedia, it says, you know, sometimes pranksters will edit your Wikipedia page. So my Wikipedia page says, in 2014, as part of his Edinburgh show, he constructed a dry stone wall using traditional methods. And I don't know who did it or why. I don't know why someone's done that. But in a way, I like it. I'm just about successful enough that every 6 months or so, someone puts a thing like that on my Wikipedia.
I was heavily sceptical that it was a real thing because I really thought I would have heard of that. But I Googled it, and then there were other articles.
Yes, there are.
So I thought maybe he did do this. So I kind of thought I should ask.
Like, interviewers now ask me, so how do you build a dry stone wall? And other articles, without even interviewing me, have just written. His projects include a 27-hour show, various novels, and famously, a dry stone wall, which he built. Once you've got that on Wikipedia, very quickly it becomes the new reality.
Presumably you have to do that show in a different venue every day, or you'd have to do constructing a dry stone wall, and then the next show is taking a dry stone wall
There
apart.
Were actually lots of technical challenges to it, not least the fact that it never happened. I've got no idea how to put it. I don't think it would have been great entertainment either. But the fact that it remained up there for months...
Still there.
It's still there.
Still there. No citation needed on there. It's a fact.
Doesn't even say this page has been...
No,
so there you go. I suppose I take it as a compliment that people think I'm capable of doing that.
Do you think that maybe you should do that show? Just as one in the eye?
I suppose it'd be one way of putting the record straight, wouldn't it? But I get the impression that it's quite hard to build a wall. Yeah, especially a dry stone wall is no... You just literally... Oh, no, I think it'd be very
dry stones,
hard.
I think, mainly it's made of.
No, I don't even know where you get dry... I suppose I'd go to home base or something, but... no, I think I'll probably crack on with the comedy if I can, yeah. If you're listening, Stuart, I'm trying really hard.
That's Robin Ince, so I better not ask you his questions.
Don't ask me why I'm fucking obsessed with science.
You did break my rib. You're indirectly responsible for breaking my rib.
Phrases like "you broke my rib" are very misleading. Yes.
It was mainly Tim Key's fault.
It's much more the fault of Tim Key. Richard was a guest on We Need Answers, an Edinburgh late show that I did, which became a TV show, and we had very high stools for the guests, and Herring... it's fair to say, broke a rib getting...
Well, yeah, I was in one of my fitness periods, so I was quite fit, and I was a bit drunk. But I've got very short legs.
Yes, so all in all, a terrible combination.
These stools are very high, so I tried to get on, couldn't get on, because of my short legs, and then Tim Key held it for me, and I was going to try and leapfrog onto it.
I know. And
but then he moved it.
Yeah, and you were sort of saying, oh, this hurts, I'm a bit sore. And it's one of those situations where you think someone's sort of whinging, and then ultimately they've got a crippling injury.
I got through the show. I didn't win. It was a competition.
It was only afterwards we found out you had a... Yeah,
it was only a crack rib. That's all it was. It's pretty horrible.
Not ideal, yeah.
I'll do anything for comedy, though, Will. I'll do anything for a laugh.
That's the kind of guys we are.
Just insane. I'm building
me too. I'll do anything
wall.
For comedy or cider.
It's been lovely to talk to you, Mark Watson. It was most of what Thanks we did was improvisation, me. My dear Mark Watson.
Yeah. It really was, my dear Richard Herring. I'm going to look it up, and if it wasn't my dear Mark Watson, I'm going to be absolutely furious.
If there is another series, can I be on? Please be on it.
At the moment, it's looking a big if.
In fact, all I want to do is the opening titles. I'm going to write it for you. I've done this for two tribes as well. People keep on going. This will be the musical.
There'll
be images of people improvising and this, and then it'll come to me and just my voice. I'll go, improvisation, my dear Mark Watson.
I can't see that not being commissioned, to be fair. My dear Herring.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my dear Mark Watson.
We'll be right back. How do you like them sky potatoes?
Thanks for watching and or listening to Rich Tang's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. No thanks for watching and not listening, though. That would be a stupid thing to do. And masturbating while you're watching it. If you're going to masturbate to it, at least listen to what we're saying at the same time. That is my message to you. Andy Hilton has paid us to say something at the end of this podcast. What he wants us to say is egg. So thank you very much for watching. Go to richterring.com/gigs to find out where I'm gigging. Come to Leicester Square Theatre to see me doing all my 12 shows over August and September. Go to gofasterstripe.com and buy a badge or a DVD if you want to help us make more of these. Thanks very much. See you next time. Goodbye.